Hello all. So now let's discuss the rapid MCQ revision series of Dr. Ankit Pharmacology series. So now we will be discussing about the various questions of GIT, okay, that is gastrointestinal tract. And in this, we will be discussing various topics. The first topic we will be discussing will be acid peptic disease, okay. Now remember, in acid peptic disease, it comprises of various disease. It's a group of disease. It comprises, you'll write hyperacidity. It also comprises peptic ulcers. Now remember, peptic ulcers can be formed in stomach as well as duodenum. It also comprises GERD, that is gastrointestinal reflux disease. And there is a bacteria which can lead to peptic ulcers, that is known as Helicobacter pylori. So we will also see the treatment of Helicobacter pylori in this section. So the first section is acid peptic disease. So let's see first what are the drugs we have for acid peptic disease. Okay, so let's see first the drugs we have for acid peptic disease. Remember, the first class of drug we have is the drug which will reduce the acid secretion from the parietal cells of stomach. So the drug which reduces acid secretion from parietal cell of stomach, what is their role in acid peptic disease? They provide round the clock protection because they will continuously suppress acid production. So the first drug we have is anti-muscarinic agent. They block M1 receptor on parietal cells. The drugs are pyrenzapine and telenzapine. Then we have H2 blockers. They block histamine 2 receptors on the stomach, which are GH type. So they are cimetidine, ranitidine, famotidine, nizatidine, and many others. Then we have the best drug or the most effective drug, that is proton pump inhibitor. They will end with the word prazole, like omeprazole, lansoprazole. Then we use one prostaglandin analog known as PGE1. So that prostaglandin E1 which is used is misoprostol, that we will discuss. Misoprostol will be given in NSAID induced peptic ulcers. Then the next class of drug we have is acid neutralizers, which are also known as antacids. They are basic drug. They chemically react with the HCl present in the stomach and they provide prompt pain relief. Okay, so what is their role? They provide prompt pain relief because they are the most rapidly acting drug. They directly neutralize the HCl present in the stomach. So we have certain systemic antacid which may absorb into the blood. So these are the salts of sodium and calcium. And then we have certain non-systemic antacids which minimally gets absorbed into the blood. These are the salts of magnesium and aluminium. Okay. Then we have ulcer protective drug. If there is an ulcer, they will form a protein covering or a peptide covering over the ulcer base. These are sucralfate and colloidal bismuth salts. Then we have certain antibiotics for Helicobacter pylori. These are clarithromycin, tetracycline, amoxicillin, metronidazole, and levofloxacin. Okay, so remember, it is levofloxacin, not ciprofloxacin. Then we have prokinetic. What prokinetics will do? Prokinetic will increase the contraction of stomach. Hence, the food which is present in the stomach will rapidly go into the intestine. Hence, it will not reflux back into the esophagus. So prokinetics are used in GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease. They are given along with proton pump inhibitors. Then we have anti-foaming drugs. So anti-foaming drugs, they will burst bubbles, okay? Anti-flatulence, which will reduce bloating, and anti-reflux drug, alginic acid, that will make a protective covering over the HCl present on the stomach, okay? So this is the complete list of the drugs which are used in acid peptic disease. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see what is the first question says. The primary role of antacids. So think about antacid, what we have discussed. The primary role of antacid is to provide prompt pain relief. The answer is prompt pain relief. Will they have ulcer healing property? No. Ulcer healing property was with sucralfate and colloidal bismuth salts. H. pylori eradication? No. For this, we give antimicrobial drugs. Now, all of the following antibiotics have been used for the treatment of H. pylori infection except. So, the answer for this question is ciprofloxacin. Okay. It is not ciprofloxacin, it is rather levofloxacin. Okay. Levofloxacin. So, let's come to the third question. Which of the following drug is most effective in healing non-steroidal induced peptic ulcer? So here we give the drugs which will reduce HCl production. And the most effective drug which reduces HCl production is proton pump inhibitors. Proton pump inhibitors, they reduce HCl production up to 80 to 99%, while H2 blockers up to 60 to 80%. Then we have anti-muscarinic agent, pyrenzapine and olanzapine, they reduce only 40 to 50%. And lastly, we have prostaglandin E1 analog. Okay, now prostaglandin E1 analog, remember, they are only given in NSAID-induced peptic ulcers. They are only given in NSAID-induced peptic ulcer. No other peptic ulcer prostaglandin E1 analog is given. The drug was misoprostol. Okay, so it is a specific drug for NSAID-induced peptic ulcer. But remember, for all peptic ulcers, the drug of choice is, even NSAID-induced peptic ulcer, the drug of choice everywhere is proton pump inhibitors. Okay, proton pump inhibitors are the most effective drug. They are used in all types of peptic ulcer. But misoprostol is a specific drug for NSAID-induced peptic ulcer. It is not used in H. pylori-induced peptic ulcers. So the answer for this question is most effective drug. Blindly mark the answer, PPIs. Okay. Now effective drug in the treatment of. Effective ulcer treatment that works by inhibiting the action of gastric acid secretion. So the answer is ranitidine. What is ranitidine? Ranitidine is an H2 blocker. Okay, H2 blocker. Now, which of the following is the drug of choice for the treatment of peptic ulcer disease? Remember, the drug of choice for treatment of any peptic ulcer disease is PPIs. That is proton pump inhibitor, and all proton pump inhibitor, they will end with the word prazole. So the answer out here is omeprazole. Okay, the answer out here is omeprazole. Now, why they are known as proton pump inhibitor? Because they inhibit proton pump in stomach. Now, remember, in chemistry, you used to call H plus as proton. Okay, so that pump is known as H plus K plus ATPase. This pump is also known as hydrogen potassium ATPase. This pump is present on parietal cells, on the luminal side of stomach. And the function of this H plus potassium ATPase is to secrete H plus and take back potassium. When H plus comes back into this lumen, what will happen to maintain the charge? The chloride also gets secreted. Okay. So remember, the function of this pump is to secrete H plus. So this proton pump is also known as H plus K plus ATPase. So omeprazole, which is a proton pump inhibitor, will be acting through inhibition of hydrogen potassium ATPase, which is the correct answer. Drugs not used in the treatment of H. pylori. So let's see what is the treatment of H. pylori first. Okay. So if you see, remember, in H. pylori, the main treatment is we give antimicrobial. These are the five classes of antimicrobial which are given. That is clarithromycin, the main drug of choice. Then we add certain other antimicrobial like amoxicillin, metronidazole or tinidazole, tetracycline and levofloxacin. Now, what is the principle of H. pylori treatment? Remember, we should give a combination of antimicrobial. We should not give a single antimicrobial, otherwise there will be development of resistance. The therapy must be given for at least 10 to 14 days. And we should also reduce HCl production by proton pump inhibitors, because proton pump inhibitor will increase the effectiveness or efficacy of antimicrobial. Okay. Now, what is the treatment? This is the treatment. When a patient comes, we give triple regimen of proton pump inhibitor with clarithromycin and any one drug among metronidazole or amoxicillin. When there is clarithromycin resistance, which is the main drug, we give quadruple regime again for 14 days. Here we will be giving four drugs. That is proton pump inhibitor, colloidal bismuth salt, tetracycline and metronidazole. There is a provision of sequential therapy also. That PPI with amoxicillin for 5 days, then PPI with clarithro and metronidazole for 6 through 10 days. And if there is still resistance, we give levofloxacin. And remember, PPI must be given twice a day, before breakfast and before evening meals. So this is the treatment of H. pylori. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see which drug is used. Clarithromycin, true, it is an antimiotic. Metronidazole, true. Omeprazole, true. There is no role of sesapride. Sesapride is a prokinetic drug. So any drug which ends with the word pride, remember it's a prokinetic drug. It is a serotonin agonist which increases motility of stomach and intestine. It is rather used in the treatment of GERD. Okay. On chronic use of which of the following drugs may cause reversible gynecomastia? Okay. The chronic use of which of the following drugs causes gynecomastia? The answer is cimetidine. Okay. Cimetidine is a H2 blocker. It was the first H2 blocker to be made. But this cimetidine has certain drawbacks. You will write that cimetidine blocks testosterone receptors. Okay. It also blocks progesterone receptors. It also blocks estrogen receptors. And cimetidine increases prolactin level. Because of this reason, as it is blocking testosterone, it causes gynecomastia and it causes impotency. And as it is blocking estrogen receptor, it may cause menstrual irregularities like hypomenorrhea. And as it is increasing prolactin level, it causes galactorrhea and infertility. Because prolactin increases milk production and suppress ovulation. Okay. So it is a side effect. That is why we made certain newer H2 blocker, which will not have any of these side effects. That is ranitidine, famotidine, nizatidine, and lastly, roxatidine. Okay. So these drugs we made. So these drugs like ranitidine, famotidine, nizatidine and roxatidine will not have any of these side effects. No side effect is seen with any of these newer H2 blocker. Okay. So they are more longer acting also. They require lesser dose. They don't have any of these side effects. Because of this reason, nowadays we have stopped using cimetidine. Now, let's come to the next question. Which of the long-term use of proton pump inhibitors is not associated with? So let's see the long-term side effects of proton pump inhibitors. So if you talk about long-term side effects of PPI, remember, PPI, they are very safe drug. Their side effect comes due to chronic usage. Because of chronic usage, there will be less HCl production in the stomach. So let's see, if there is less HCl production, it will lead to the reduced absorption of calcium, which may lead to osteoporosis, which may increase the risk of hip fracture. And especially women in postmenopausal age, they are more prone to develop osteoporosis. They reduce iron and magnesium absorption as well. But remember, they don't have any effect on vitamin B12 absorption. Because vitamin B12 absorption depends upon intrinsic factor, PPIs, they don't suppress intrinsic factor. They only reduce production of HCl. Now, you know that HCl is the part of innate immunity. Okay, innate immunity. So the point is, innate immunity, if there is HCl is less, it may increase the risk of infection, especially stomach infection, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, and it may also cause pseudomembranous colitis. And these bacteria may go reflux back into the to the lungs also. And what we have seen in long term, they may cause increased risk of community acquired pneumonias. In long term, it has been now proven that PPIs increase the risk of Alzheimer's disease or dementia. And there is a theoretical risk, which have been proven in rats but not in humans, that they may cause gastrinomas or Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, because HCl is suppressed. Suppression of HCl increases gastrin level, because gastrin feedback is given by HCl. So if there's less HCl, there is no feedback on gastrin. So there could be a benign tumor of gastrinomas. So keep this thing in mind. So let's see the option. Increased incidence of community-acquired pneumonia, absolutely true. Increased risk of Clostridium difficile infection is absolutely true. Increased risk of hip fracture in female, yes, because of reduced calcium absorption, the answer is C. So this is a false statement. They don't have any effect on thyroid profile. Okay. Now, despite short half-life, proton pump inhibitors can cause prolonged acid suppression up to 48 hours because, now remember, if a drug has a half-life is very less, but its action is very long, These drugs are known as hit and run drugs. So proton pump inhibitors are an examples of hit and run drugs. Why? Because they bind to hit and run drugs, they bind to their target like H plus K plus ATPase. In which fashion? They bind to their H plus K plus ATPase in an irreversible fashion. Okay, they bind to this pump irreversible fashion, and this pump becomes permanently dead. It cannot function. And to synthesize a new pump, at least 2 to 5 days are required. So if you will give one proton pump inhibitor, their action will last up to 2 days, and their activity will be regained after stoppage will be after 2 to 5 days. Okay, so this is the reason. So keeping this thing in mind, the answer for this option is they irreversibly inhibit proton pump molecule, and acid secretion requires new synthesis of proton pump. Okay, acid secretion requires new synth. Now the drug which is not used in H. pylori infection, omeprazole PPIs, they are used. Amoxicillin, antibiotic, metronidazole, yes. Mozapride is not used. Again, mozapride like sisapride is a prokinetic drug. Prokinetic drugs are rather used in the treatment of gastroesophageal reflux disease. So the next question is asking now, which of the following agents is beneficial in NSAID-induced peptic ulcers or gastric ulcer? The answer is PGE1 analog. The drug name is PGE1 analog was misoprostol. Okay, the drug was misoprostol. A proton pump inhibitors are most effective when they are given in. Remember, PPIs, they are most effective when they are given at least 1 hour before meals. When they are given at least 1 hour before meals, the reason is before meals, there will be least HCl in the stomach because meal induces HCl production. Hence, remember, PPIs, they are degraded in presence of HCl. They are degraded in the presence of HCl. And the second point is, before meals, there is maximum activity of H plus K plus ATPase. Okay? There is maximum activity of H plus K plus ATPase. Hence, the answer for this question is, they should be given shortly before meals. Okay? So now the next question, 14th, is asking, gynecomastia can occur as a side effect of, we have already discussed, it's cimetidine. So just write the list of the drugs which causes gynecomastia, that is DISCO, that is digoxin, an inotropic drug in heart, isoniazid, anti-tubercular drug, spironolactone, cimetidine, which was asked in our question, ketoconazole and estrogens. Okay, estrogens. So this is the complete list of the drugs which causes gynecomastia. Okay, gynecomastia, DISCO. So ranitidine differs from cimetidine in the following respect. So we know that only cimetidine has endocrinal side effect, they were blocking. So it is less potent, it's false. Remember, ranitidine is more potent than cimetidine. More potent means it will require lesser dose. It is a shorter acting, false. Remember, ranitidine is longer acting. But among overall, the longest and the most potent H2 blocker is famotidine. The longest and the most potent is famotidine. It does not have anti-androgenic effect. It's absolutely true. It is only seen with cimetidine. And the last option is, it produces more CNS effect, false. Remember, cimetidine can enter into blood-brain barrier. It can enter into brain. And it can produce various neuropsychiatric disturbances, like behavioral change, psychosis, daydreaming, etc. Okay? So the answer is C. In peptic ulcers, antacids are now primarily used for prompt pain relief, we have already discussed. Drugs employed for anti-H. pylori therapy include all of the following. Clarithro, true. Tinidazole, true. Amoxicillin, true. It is not ciprofloxacin, it is rather levofloxacin. Okay, it is rather levofloxacin. Drug used for the peptic ulcers caused by, due to chronic use of NSAIDs. Remember, we can use every drug, but the drug of choice for any peptic ulcers is proton pump inhibitors. Okay, proton pump inhibitors. But misoprostol has the only use out here. Misoprostol is the specific drug for NSAID-induced peptic ulcer, while PPIs are the drug of choice for NSAID-induced peptic ulcers. Okay, now M1 blocker used in peptic ulcer, the answer was pyrenzapine and telenzapine. Antacid combinations of magnesium and aluminium salts are superior to the single component. Let's see why. Let's see the difference between magnesium salts of antacids and aluminium salts of antacid. Okay, aluminium salt. Remember, magnesium is fast acting. Magnesium is fast acting. Okay, aluminium has a sustained or slow effect. Magnesium, remember, produces diarrhea. It has a laxative effect. Aluminium, remember, produces constipation. Okay? Constipation. Okay? And similarly, magnesium increases GIT emptying because of increasing motility. Aluminium reduces GIT emptying. Stomach emptying or GIT emptying. So can we say if we will be combining them together, they will produce fast as well as slow response and they will not have much effect on GIT motility. And the great advantage is we can reduce their dose also. We can reduce their dose to the half. Okay, so these are the three advantages. It will produce both fast and slow action. It will have negligible effect on GIT motility. And we can reduce the effect of the drug. Okay, so the answer for this question number 20 comes out to be all of the above. So let's see, they have rapid as well as sustained effect. It's absolutely true. They are like less likely to be effect in gastric emptying. It's absolutely true. And bowel movement, true. Okay, remember this part. Okay, now what is the side effect of aluminium containing antacids? Remember, aluminium containing antacid, they reduce phosphate absorption from GIT. Because of reduced phosphate absorption in GIT, they may cause hypophosphatemia, which can lead to osteoporosis. It can lead to osteoporosis. Now remember, both these magnesium and aluminium salts should not be given in renal failure. The reason is magnesium in renal failure, the level will increase, which can produce cardiac arrhythmias. And aluminium, if the level increases, produces encephalopathy. It may damage brain. Hence, in renal failure, the drug of choice among antacid becomes out to be calcium salts, especially calcium bicarbonate. Okay, we give them. But remember, calcium also produces constipation. Diarrhea is only produced, so calcium and aluminium produces constipation. Magnesium produces diarrhea. Okay, so this is the complete summary of antacids. Now, drug used in the treatment of gastric ulcer due to H. pylori is, that is, colloidal bismuth substitrate. Okay, we have already discussed. Which of the following is not an effect of ranitidine as compared to cimetidine? Remember, they both are H2 blocker, true. They both are H2 blocker. They are given orally, absolutely true. They can be used along with proton pump blockers. Yes, you can combine them. Ranitidine and cimetidine, they both have anti-androgenic effect. The answer is absolutely false. Anti-androgenic effect is only and only seen with cimetidine. It is not seen with ranitidine or any other H2 blocker. Okay? Now, the next question is asking, antipeptic ulcer drug that can be given in the patient of chronic renal failure, I believe we have already discussed, that was calcium bicarbonate. So, calcium bicarbonate is the antacid of choice in chronic renal failure. Okay. Now, inhibition of HCl, secretion by omeprazole occurs within an hour. It reaches peak in 2 hours and plateaus by day 4. After how many days the secretion gradually normalizes? Remember, when we give PPI, the action comes within 1 to 2 hours. Try to remember 2 hours. The peak will be 2 days. And the action will normalize after 2 to 5 days. Another 2 to 5 days. Okay. This is the answer. Another 2 to 5 days. Hence, you will go by this option 3 to 5 days. Hence, you will go by the option 3 to 5 days. Okay. So, action comes, starts within 2 hours. Peak in 2 days. It will take another 2 to 5 days to normalize. Now, following appears to affect the integrity of adherent gel on sucralfate interfering with the action. Now, what is sucralfate? Remember, sucralfate is an ulcer protective drug. How does it act? Remember, the word sucralfate stands for, it has 3 words, sucrose, aluminium, sulfate. So, if you will take this initial word, that is sucralfate, it will become sucralfate. SU stands for sucrose, AL stands for aluminium, fate stands for sulfate. Okay, so sucralfate. Now, how does it produce its action? Suppose this is an ulcer and this is an ulcer base. Okay. Now, this sucralfate in the pH less than 4, when the pH is less than 4 or acidic, in this pH, remember, sucralfate polymerizes. In low pH or acidic pH, sucralfate polymerizes along with proteins, which is present in food as well as in the dead cells. So it will polymerize and it will polymerize itself and with proteins, and it will form a protective covering over this ulcer base. So this is the main action. So it requires itself get polymerized with the presence of protein. Hence, the proteins present in the foodstuff along with sucralfate, remember, makes a protective covering over the ulcer base. But the important point is sucralfate requires low pH to polymerize. It requires low pH to polymerize. Hence, this sucralfate should not be given with H2 blockers, proton pump inhibitors, and antacids. Because all these drugs, they tend to increase pH. Because H2 blocker and PPI, they will reduce the production of HCl. HCl is an acidic. Antacids will directly increase the pH. So these drugs, sucralfate, should not be combined with H2 blocker, PPI and antacids. Otherwise, it will not polymerize an acidic pH. So it requires acidic pH for its action. Okay. So remember this part. So let's move forward now. Now, which of the following proton pump inhibitor has maximum CYP inhibiting activity? So let's talk about certain properties of PPI. So omeprazole, you will write, it has maximum CYP inhibiting activity. It is CYP inhibitor. So it is an enzyme inhibitor. Least enzyme inhibition is by, we will write, pantoprazole. If pantoprazole is not given in the option, you will go by the answer rabeprazole. Okay. You'll write most potent. Most potent is dexrabeprazole. If dexrabeprazole is not given, then you will write lansoprazole. If lansoprazole is not given, then you will write rabeprazole, or elaprazole is also there. So overall is dexrabeprazole and lansoprazole. Okay. The PPIs which are given by injections as well. Remember, all are given orally. All PPIs can be given orally, but some are given by injection. You will write pantoprazole, S-omeprazole, and rabeprazole. So these are given. And the safest PPI in pregnancy is, the safest PPI in pregnancy is lansoprazole. But remember, we can use other PPIs as well, but the data with lansoprazole is best. The unsafe PPI in pregnancy is omeprazole, because it has endocrinal side effect. The only unsafe PPI in pregnancy is omeprazole. So these are the certain properties with PPIs. So let's talk about this point, which has maximum CYP inhibitory activity, that is omeprazole. So answer for this question is omeprazole. Which of the following drug is not used in H. pylori treatment? Oxytetracycline, false. Remember, it is tetracycline, not oxytetracycline. Bismuth compound, true. Amoxicillin, true. PPI, true. So the answer out here is oxytetracycline. A patient with peptic ulcers was combined with ranitidine and sucralfate in the morning hours. Why this combination is irrational, it is unjustifiable. So can we say that ranitidine will increase the pH by suppressing HCl production and sucralfate will not able to polymerize? We have already discussed. So the answer is C. Because ranitidine will increase the pH above 4 and sucralfate requires acidic pH to polymerize. Sucralfate will not able to act. So sucralfate does not polymerize. Okay. Now patient is taking famotidine. Famotidine is an H2 blocker. Sucralfate and antacid. Same question again. This treatment is irrational. The reason is sucralfate only polymerizes when the pH is less than 4. And H2 blocker and antacids will tend to increase the pH. Okay. Choose the correct statement about H2 blockers. So the first statement is asking they are the most efficacious drug in inhibiting acid secretion. False. Remember, it is PPIs, not H2 blockers. They caused faster healing of duodenal ulcers. The answer is false. Again, the most fastest healing is by PPI. They prevent stress ulcers in the stomach. Remember, true. PPIs, H2 blockers, they are the drug of choice for stress ulcer. H2 blockers, they are the drug of choice for stress ulcer. But nowadays, we have started using PPIs also. They afford most prompt pain relief. False. Remember, prompt pain relief is a function of antacids. Not H2 blocker, not PPIs. Most efficacious drug in inhibiting round-the-clock acid secretion was PPIs, proton pump inhibitors. And they end with the word prazole. Choose the correct statement about colloidal bismuth substitrate. Okay. So if you talk about colloidal bismuth substitrate, remember, it's an ulcer protective drug. It's an ulcer protective drug. It has H. pylori activity. It inhibits H. pylori. And remember, it also increases prostaglandin E1 production. So remember the 3 P's of colloidal bismuth substitrate. Okay. Now the point is, what is the correct statement about this? Let's see. It causes prolonged neutralization of acid reduction. False. Remember, it is the function of antacids, not ulcer protective. It has anti H. pylori effect activity. Yes, we have discussed. It is used in anti H. pylori regime. It relieves peptic ulcer pain promptly. False. Again, it is a function of antacids. Okay. So the answer is it has anti H. pylori activity, colloidal bismuth substitrate. Now, what is the side effect of this drug? Remember, bismuth is black in color. Hence, it causes black tongue and black feces. And some rare cases of Reye syndrome have been reported with colloidal bismuth compounds. Okay. Remember. Now, the following is true of anti-H. pylori therapy. It is indicated for all patients of peptic ulcer. It's absolutely false. Why we should give anti-H. pylori therapy or antimicrobial for all patients of peptic ulcer? Okay. It is only given in which there is a proven anti-H. pylori therapy. Resistance to any single antimicrobial develops very rapidly. True. That is why we give a combination of drugs. Concurrent suppression of acid secretion enhances efficacy of regime. We have already discussed. True. Colloidal bismuth substitrate, it directly inhibits H. pylori. But it has a poor patient availability. Yes, because the coloring abnormality, it's absolutely true. So the answer for this question is A. The most specific drug for the treatment of peptic ulcer due to aspirin. Remember, aspirin is NSAID. And misoprostol is only used in this condition. No other peptic ulcer we use misoprostol. So it's a specific drug for NSAID-induced peptic ulcer. But the drug of choice for any peptic ulcer is omeprazole or proton pump inhibitors. Choose the anti-ulcer drugs that inhibit gastric acid secretion, stimulate gastric mucus and bicarbonate secretion, and has a cytoprotective action on gastric mucosa. That means everything. The answer for this question is misoprostol. Okay? Now remember, misoprostol is a PGE1 analog. Okay? Now, PGE1 analog misoprostol, remember, it reduces HCl production. How it reduces HCl production? It acts on parietal cells of stomach by acting on a receptor known as EP3 receptor. E stands for prostaglandin E, P means prostanoid receptor. By acting on this receptor, it reduces HCl production. It also increases mucus and it also increases bicarbonate. Remember, mucus and bicarbonate are protective factors. And it acts on which cells? We will write, it acts on goblet cells, which increases mucus production, and other epithelial cells, which can reduce, increase HCl production by acting on receptor EP2 and EP4. And these factors, they increase production. So misoprostol has all effect. Okay. Now cimetidine inhibits the metabolism of all of the following drugs except. Now the point is, you have to remember that cimetidine is a CYP inhibitor. Okay, it's a CYP inhibitor. Which CYP? Remember, CYP 3A4 and CYP 2C9. Now CYP 3A4, remember, benzodiazepines like diazepam, they get metabolized. CYP 2C9, warfarin and phenytoin gets metabolized. Okay, they get metabolized. So the answer for this question becomes out to be ketoconazole. Okay, ketoconazole. So it increases the metabolism of phenytoin, warfarin and diazepam. Okay, so it inhibits these respective CYPs. NSAID induced ulcer is best treated by, remember, for any peptic ulcer, the drug of choice is PPIs. Try to find proton pump inhibitor D. Antacids drug typically causing diarrhea. Diarrhea is caused by magnesium. And constipation is caused by aluminium salts and calcium salts. So the answer out here is magnesium hydroxide. All are H2 blocker except omeprazole. Omeprazole is a proton pump inhibitor. A patient with Zollinger-Ellison syndrome due to gastrinoma has two bleeding ulcer and diarrhea. The drug that irreversibly inhibit sodium hydrogen potassium ATPase is omeprazole. Remember, omeprazole is the drug of choice for Zollinger-Ellison syndrome to decrease HCl production. Okay, but remember, we have to also reduce the production of gastrin hormone. To reduce the production of gastrin hormone, we give octreotide. Octreotide is a somatostatin hormone. Okay, so their combination is generally given. So answer is omeprazole. Which of the following drug does not change the pH of stomach? The answer is sucralfate. Sucralfate is an ulcer protective drug. While ranitidine, H2 blocker and proton pump inhibitor, they will reduce HCl production. The pH may increase. Which of the following is true regarding omeprazole? So which of the following is true regarding omeprazole? Let's talk about this question number 42. It causes leiomyoma. It's absolutely true, or yes. Certain cases of leiomyoma have been reported with omeprazole. Okay. Then it causes, it is a competitive antagonist of histamine receptor. It's absolutely false. I'm really sorry. Let's talk about this question again. So now, which of the following is true regarding omeprazole? It causes leiomyoma. Remember, it's false. Omeprazole may rather decrease estrogen level. Leiomyoma occur due to higher level of estrogen sometimes. It is a competitive antagonist of histamine receptor. The answer is false. It is rather a irreversible inhibitor of proton pump. It's a PPI. It's an anti-cancer drug, false. It is implicated in causation of gastric carcinoid in tumors in rats. It's absolutely true. We have already seen the side effect of long-term side effect of proton pump inhibitor. They may cause gastrinomas in rats. Action of which of the following is not affected by food? The answer for this question is, remember, ranitidine, roxatidine and famotidine. Okay, the action of cimetidine is affected by food. It is affected by food. So the fourth complete list of the drugs whose absorption is increased or decreased by the food, you can see the club. There is a post out there and the whole concept is given in our videos, complete video series. Which of the following is a constipating antacid, which will cause constipation? You will go by the answer aluminium and calcium. They both are constipating. But remember, aluminium causes more constipation as compared to calcium. If you have to choose one, you will go by aluminium. Which of the following is not a recommended gastric antacid? So which is not an antacid? We give the salts of sodium, calcium, magnesium and aluminium. These four salts are given as antacid. So which is not? We will write silicon dioxide. Okay. A patient is detected to have acid peptic disease. He was given omeprazole, which is a PPI, proton pump inhibitor, antacids and sucralfate. What is the defect in rationale? We have already discussed. Sucralfate require acidic pH. Sucralfate require acidic pH less than 4. And these two drugs, they will try to increase the pH. Hence, what should be the correct answer for this question? The answer will be B. Antacid should not be given with sucralfate as it requires low pH for its activation. So this is all about acid peptic disease. Okay. So now let's discuss about emetics and anti-emetic drugs. Okay. So before going further with the question, let's discuss what is the various classification of emetics and anti-emetic drugs we have. So let's see the classification of anti-emetics first. So how vomiting occurs, remember there is an area known as CTZ area, which is also known as chemoreceptor trigger zone. It's sometimes known as area of prostrema also. And it is the vomiting center of our brain. And remember, it lies outside the blood-brain barrier. So it's a part of brain which is not protected by blood-brain barrier. Now let's see what are the different anti-emetic agents. So first class of agent we have, which are used in the various types of sicknesses like motion sickness, seasickness and morning sickness. So why this sickness arises? This sickness arises from the vestibule of the ear. Why? Because when endolymph in the vestibule of the ear rotates, the nerves, vestibular nerves, they go to cerebellum and from cerebellum they stimulate CTZ area by muscarinic and histaminic receptor. Hence, we will block these receptors and due to muscarinic and histaminic stimulation, there is a feeling of nausea and vomiting. Hence, we will block anti-muscarinic drug and we will give anti-histaminic drug which can enter into the brain. So, these are the drugs which we give for motion sickness, seasickness and morning sickness. So one anticholinergic drug or anti-muscarinic agent, that is hyoscine, which is also known as scopolamine. And we also give antihistaminic drug like diphenhydramine, cinarizine, cyclizine, meclizine. And for morning sickness, we give doxylamine and B6. Okay. Then if there is a psychological component or anticipatory nausea and vomiting, we calm a patient. We give sedative drugs like benzodiazepines. Now the major cause of vomiting is due to GIT damage. What could be the cause of GIT damage? Suppose you have given an anti-cancer drug. Anti-cancer drug, they damage the cells of GIT. You have given radiotherapy. Suppose after post-operative nausea and vomiting and gastritis. There is inflammation and this inflammation releases various mediators through vagus nerve. Vagus nerve releases various mediators which come directly to CTZ area and through blood also. So if there is serotonin stimulation by 5-HT3 receptor, it leads to vomiting. Hence, we give 5-HT3 antagonists. The drugs are ondansetron, granisetron, dolacetron, pelonocetron. So, if there is dopamine stimulation of D2 receptor, Again, there is vomiting. Hence, we give D2 blocker or D2 antagonist. The drugs are antipsychotics, metoclopramide and domperidone. Then when there is release of substance P, as substance P stimulate NK1 receptor, which is neurokinin 1 receptor. So we block NK1 receptor. The drugs is epripitant, netiopitant and rolapitant. So they are ending with the word pitant. The first one they were ending with the word cetron. Okay. And lastly, we stimulate cannabinoid receptor. Remember, cannabinoids, they suppress vomiting. Okay. Cannabinoids, they suppress vomiting. So these are the drugs. So these motion sickness and sickness wale drug, they are used in, they are antimuscarinic and antihistaminic, and all these drugs, they are given in all these conditions. So corticosteroids are also used. So let's talk about the treatment of chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting first. That is due to anti-cancer drug like cisplatin, cyclophosphamide, etc. So in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting, the first drug we start is generally 5-HT3 antagonist. They block serotonin 3 receptors on CTZ area. They are effective only in early phase, which the vomiting lasts within 24 hours. They are effective. The drugs are ondansetron and granisetron. But remember, pelonocetron is the longest acting drug. It is also effective in delayed phase, the vomiting which lasts for more than 24 hours. Then we also combine NK1 antagonist and dexamethasone. NK1 antagonist, they will end with the word pitant. So they are the drug of choice. Pitant drugs are the drug of choice for delayed phase of nausea and vomiting. Then we have CB1 agonist, cannabinoid agonist, dronabinol and nabilon. They are given as an add-on drug in resistant cases. They increase appetite also, because in cancer patient there is severe weight loss. So they help in restoring the weight of a person. Okay. So remember this part. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the drug. The drugs used in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting, epripitant, it's absolutely true. Corticosteroid, absolutely true. Ondansetron, absolutely true. The answer is all of the above. Now, which of the following 5-HT receptor plays an important role in causing emesis? That was 5-HT3. So the answer is 5-HT3. All of the following are true about metoclopramide. So let's talk about metoclopramide now. So what is metoclopramide? Metoclopramide is a kind of a prokinetic drug. Okay. So what are prokinetic? Prokinetic means they increase GIT motility. Okay. So let's talk about first metoclopramide, then we will come to prokinetic. So what is metoclopramide? It's a congener of procainamide. They both are ending with the word amide. Now, it has various action. It has D2 receptor blocking action. Due to dopamine receptor blocking action on CTZ area, it has anti-emetic action. Okay. So it is used in post-operative nausea and vomiting. It also, due to D2 receptor, it increases the motility of stomach. Hence, the food will pass from stomach to intestine. Remember, it is the only drug which is approved for the treatment of gastroparesis. Okay, gastroparesis means when the stomach is not contracting. It is also given in GERD, when the stomach content is moving upwards into the esophagus. It also have 5-HT4 agonist activity, serotonin agonist activity, which helps in releasing acetylcholine, which produces prokinetic action on stomach and intestine. In stomach, it is used for gastroparesis and GERD, and intestine, it is used for the treatment of constipation. And in very high dose, which is generally not seen, it also have 5-HT3 blocking property, to which it could provide an anti-emetic action, but it is only seen in very high dose. The problem with metoclopramide is it can enter into blood-brain barrier. And when it enters into blood-brain barrier, it can cause Parkinson's disease. It can increase prolactin level. Okay, that is why we developed a D2 blocker, domperidone, which will not enter into the brain, which will not produce Parkinson's disease and prolactin level. Okay, so this is the complete list of prokinetics and where they are used. The prokinetic, they increase GIT motility, either stomach or intestine. Generally, they increase both of them. So by increasing stomach motility, we can use in these three conditions, and by increasing intestinal motility, we can use in constipation. So metoclopramide, D2 blocker, 5-HT4 agonist and 5-HT3 antagonist. Then we made specific D2 blocker, that is domperidone, losaridone, antipsychotics and etopride. Then 5-HT4 agonist, sizapride, mozapride, renzapride, prucalopride and tigasirod. Among them, sizapride got banned because it was causing torsades de pointes or various arrhythmias. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about now these questions. Now, all of the following are true for metoclopramide except it is chemically related to procainamide. Absolutely true. It speeds up gastric emptying, yes, because it's a prokinetic drug. Okay? It stimulates chemoreceptor trigger zone, false, rather it suppresses it. That is why it produces anti-emetic action. It blocks D2 receptor, it's absolutely true, so the answer will be C. Now, all of the following are effective in cytotoxic or anti-cancer drug induced nausea and vomiting. The answer we have discussed is dronabinol, true, metoclopramide, true, and then citron, true. The answer is hyoscine. Hyoscine, remember, is given in motion sickness. Okay, it is given in motion sickness, not in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. It starts from ear, vestibule of the ear. Anti-emetic used in vomiting induced by anti-cancer drug, ondansetron, it's absolutely true. Sizapride, not used. It is a prokinetic drug. It is given for GERD and constipation. Same with metoclopramide. Trifluparazine is an antipsychotic drug. They all are D2 blocker. D2 blockers are generally not used in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. We give ondansetron 5-HT3 antagonist. So the answer is ondansetron. Which drug is given in delayed? Remember, delayed phase comes. Mark the answer, NK1 antagonist, aprepitant. Okay, delayed phase. Drug given for metoclopramide induced dystonic reaction. Now remember, metoclopramide can block D2 receptor in brain because it can enter into blood-brain barrier. Hence, it can produce extrapyramidal symptoms. It can produce extrapyramidal symptoms by blocking D2 receptor in basal ganglia, which are similar to Parkinson's disease. So can we say it is a cause of drug-induced Parkinsonism? Remember, the drug of choice for drug-induced Parkinsonism is, we give anticholinergic drugs or first-generation antihistaminic drugs. Okay, so those anticholinergic drugs we will write as benztropine, biperidine, and benzhexol. First generation antihistaminics, we can use promethazine because they have anticholinergic property only, and diphenhydramine. So they are the drug of choice for drug-induced extrapyramidal symptoms or Parkinson's disease. Mark the answer as promethazine. Okay. So the answer is promethazine. Drug implicated in prolonging QT interval. The answer was sizapride. Remember, sizapride was a substrate of CYP3A4. By CYP3A4, it was degraded in the body. And there were two drugs which were inhibiting CYP3A4. That was ketoconazole and erythromycin. Ketoconazole and erythromycin inhibit CYP3A4, which may increase toxicity of sizapride. And its toxicity was, it was causing increase in QT interval on ECG, which was causing fatal ventricular fibrillation known as torsades de pointis. And the patients were dying suddenly. And because of this reason, it got banned. Sizapride got banned because of erythromycin and ketoconazole. Okay. There was one more drug which was got banned because of similar reason. That was tigasirod. Okay. Tigasirod. Okay. So, anti-emetic action is produced through decreased CTZ stimulation. It's absolutely true. H1 agonist action, it's absolutely false. Remember, it is antihistaminic drug. We have to block H1 action in sicknesses, motion sickness, morning sickness. D1 antagonist action, false. It is D2 antagonist. D2 receptor are present in CTZ area. Olfactory apparatus stimulation, false. It will rather produce vomiting. 5-HT4 agonist action, remember, it is rather a prokinetic action. 5-HT4 receptor are present in GIT. Okay, so the answer is A. So the answer for this question is A. Okay, now let's move forward. In case of hill journey, anti-motion sickness drugs are best administered. Remember, anti-motion sickness should be given 1 hour before the start of journey. Okay, to suppress labyrinth or vestibular nerve. Because if they have been stimulated, the impulse will reach to the CTZ area. We have to prevent the impulse to reach to the CTZ area so that the vomiting should not occur. Okay, so that the vomiting should not occur. Which of the following prokinetic drug produces extra pyramidal effect? So the answer we have already discussed, that drug which was entering into blood-brain barrier was metoclopramide. It enters into blood-brain barrier and it blocks D2 receptor, which may produce Parkinson's-like effect. What about sizapride? Remember, sizapride is a prokinetic drug. It is serotonin or 5-HT4 receptor agonist. Domperidone also a D2 blocker. But remember, domperidone does not cross blood-brain barrier. And the answer for this question is metoclopramide. Okay? Now, the most effective anti-emetic drug in controlling cisplatin-induced vomiting is... We use ondansetron among them. Okay? Ondansetron is the correct answer. Okay? Now, which of the following dronabinol is also used, but remember, dronabinol is not much effective. It is only given as an add-on drug in resistant cases. There is no role of D2 blocker. Okay? D2 blockers, they have no role. Which of the following prokinetic drug has been implicated in causing serious ventricular arrhythmia? Particularly in patient receiving erythromycin or ketoconazole, we have discussed those two drugs. These were sizapride and tigasirod. It is mainly sizapride. If that is not given, you can mark the answer tigasirod. Okay? And it got banned because of this reason. A patient is on cisplatin, which is an anti-cancer drug or chemotherapy, has vomiting. Third day of treatment. Third means after 24 hours. So it is a delayed phase of vomiting. And for delayed phase of vomiting, remember the best drug we have is NK1 antagonist. For early phase, we have cetron wale drug, ondansetron. But for delayed phase, we have drug NK1 antagonist, that is aprepitant. They are the drug of choice for delayed phase. So mark the answer as aprepitant. Ondansetron, remember, it is given for early phase. These drugs have no role. Drugs stimulating 5-HT4 receptor to act as a prokinetic drug is all of the following except renzapride, true, and sizapride, true. Pride word will come, 5-HT4. Metoclopramide, we have discussed D2, 5-HT4, and 5-HT3. While domperidone only and only D2 blocker. So I'll show you that list again of prokinetic drugs. So this was the list we have discussed. Okay. So metoclopramide is having action on all receptors. Domperidone only on D2 receptor. Pride wale drug only on 5-HT4 receptor. So the answer out here is not having action on 5-HT4 receptor is domperidone. Okay. Prokinetic drug without D2 blockage is sizapride. Okay? Sizapride. So metoclopramide true, domperidone true, antipsychotic like clopromazine true. They have D2 blocking property. Metoclopramide inhibit cholinergic smooth muscle stimulation of gastrointestinal tract. So let's come to that metoclopramide part. I told you that metoclopramide releases acetylcholine. Okay? It releases acetylcholine. Okay, so let's see, these are the answers. So let's talk about it. Inhibits cholinergic stimulation of gastrointestinal folds. It's absolutely false. It rather stimulates them. It rather releases acetylcholine, which causes contraction. It decreases the lower esophageal sphincter. It's absolutely false. It rather increases or close lower esophageal sphincter or increase the tone. That is why metoclopramide is used, because of the release of acetylcholine. Because of this reason, metoclopramide is used in GERD. It stimulates D2 receptor faults. It rather blocks them. It increases intestinal peristalsis. Yes, it's a prokinetic drug. So answer is true. It is a prokinetic. That means it increases intestinal motility. So the answer is D. For chemotherapy induced vomiting, 5-HT antagonist used is Cetron. Find a word, Cetron. Ondansetron acts by 5-HT3 antagonism. And where it is acting? It is acting on CTZ area. It blocks 5-HT3 receptor on CTZ area. No, it has no action on D2 receptor. It has no effect on GIT motility. It has no effect on acetylcholine. It is a pure 5-HT3 antagonist acting on CTZ area. Metoclopramide has following action except it increases lower esophageal tone. Absolutely true. That is why due to the release of acetylcholine, it closes lower esophageal sphincter. Prokinetic action is blocked by atropine. It's false. Remember, prokinetic action is mainly due to 5-HT4 agonist property. It increases gastric peristalsis. True, true. So the answer out here is this one. Now, which anti-emetic drug selectively blocks levodopa-induced vomiting? Remember, levodopa in our body gets converted into dopamine. And dopamine goes to the CTZ area and act on a receptor known as D2 receptor. And if this D2 receptor is stimulated, remember, it leads to nausea and vomiting. So we have to give a drug which will only block this D2 receptor, which is lying outside the blood-brain barrier, CTZ area. So that drug is domperidone. Domperidone is the drug of choice because it is a D2 blocker and it does not enter into blood-brain barrier. If it is entering into blood-brain barrier, don't you think it will reduce the effect of levodopa in treating Parkinson's disease? Okay. So remember, metoclopramide can also block, but remember, metoclopramide can block levodopa effect in Parkinson's disease also. Levodopa effect in Parkinson's disease will be blocked by metoclopramide because it will enter into the brain. Sizapride has action on 5-HT4. Ondansetron has an action of 5-HT3. They don't have any relation with dopamine. Activation of which of the following receptors in myenteric neuron by metoclopramide is presently responsible for enhanced acetylcholine release? I think we have already discussed that is 5-HT4 agonist property. So I'll show you that slide again. See this one. 5-HT4 releases acetylcholine, which increases motility of intestine and stomach. So the answer out here is serotonergic 5-HT4 receptors. Indicate the drug that which does not improve lower esophageal tone or prevent reflux, but it is used in the first line treatment of GERD. Now, the answer is treatment of GERD is, remember, proton pump inhibitors plus prokinetic. Now, prokinetic, they will increase lower esophageal sphincter tone and they increase gastric motility so that the food should not be reflux backward, while PPI will decrease HCl production. So this is the treatment of GERD. PPIs with prokinetic drug. So the answer out here is omeprazole. Omeprazole is a PPI. Okay. Mozapride and metoclopramide are prokinetic drug. Okay. Prokinetic drugs. Okay. Now, alginate is an anti-reflux drug. Okay. And aluminium hydroxide is an antacids. Okay. Ondansetron act by inhibiting which of the following receptor? 5-HT3 receptors. Cetron, 5-HT3. Which of the following drugs is not used in motion sickness? Remember, in motion sickness, I told you anti-muscarinic and antihistaminic drug that block M1 and H1 receptor. Okay, so the answer out here is metoclopramide. Metoclopramide, it is not used for motion sickness. Cyclizine is an antihistaminic. Cinarizine again is an antihistaminic. Scopolamine is anti-muscarinic drug. Okay. Which of the following drug is used to control post-operative nausea and vomiting? So post-operative nausea and vomiting, we can use any drug which is stimulating CTZ area. So we can give droperidol or ondansetron. Okay. Patients on sizatriptan for gastroesophageal reflux develops upper respiratory tract infection and patient prescribes erythromycin. So remember that interaction. What pharmacological interaction would be seen? There will be fatal ventricular arrhythmias. We know that sizatriptan got banned because of fatal ventricular arrhythmia due to increase in QTA prolongation, which was causing torsades de pointis, and it got banned because of erythromycin and ketoconazole. Now metoclopramide is useful in all of the following except, remember, in motion sickness these drugs have no role. It can be given, yes, can be given. Anti-MS is true. Promoting lactation, yes, because it increases prolactin release. Okay. So if motion sickness word is not given, then you can go by the answer chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Although they are not given in chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting also, but the best answer out here is motion sickness if you want to choose the one answer. Okay, so remember this part. So now let's discuss the various drugs which are used for the treatment of diarrhea, constipation and irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, irritable bowel syndrome. So let's see the list of the drugs which are used in various conditions first. So the drugs which are used in the treatment of constipation, they are known as laxative drugs or purgative drugs. So these drugs are used in the treatment of constipation. So the first drug we have is a bulk laxative. They will go into the intestine. They will absorb water on their surface. Their bulk will increase, which will stretch the muscles. When the muscles are stretched, they will contract those muscles. The muscle will start contracting spontaneously. So these drugs are known as bulk laxatives. They are known as dietary fibers or prebiotics as well. Now the drugs are bran, psyllium. Psyllium is also known as metamucil, ispagula and methylcellulose. Then we have a drug which will directly go and stimulate intestinal contraction. So the drugs are known as stimulant or irritant laxatives. They are phenolphthalein, bisacodyl and sodium picosulfate. Phenolphthalein got banned because of carcinogenic risk. Then we have anthrols, which are plant product like senna and cascara. Senna, remembers, turns the color of intestine black. It causes melanosis coli. Prokinetic drug which will increase intestinal motility, 5-HT4 agonist procalobrite, and certain oils like castor oil. Then we have osmotic laxatives. They will increase osmotic pressure, which will stretch the muscles and which will increase fluid secretion. These are magnesium salts. Saline purgatives like sodium salts, polyethylene glycol, mannitol, sorbitol, isosorbide and lactulose. Lactulose is given in hepatic encephalopathy because it will reduce the absorption of ammonia. Then we have certain chloride secretors given in resistant cases only, lubiprostron, which is a prostaglandin E1 analog. And then we have linaclotide and plicanatide, which stimulates various receptors like guanyl cyclase receptor, which increases the secretion of chloride. Then we have certain miscellaneous drugs like opioid antagonists like LV, Mopan. Mopan means M for mu, OP means for opioid, AN means antagonist. Naloxone, nalmidine, these are used in opioid induced constipation. Then we have cholinergic drug like neostigmine and bethanicol. They increase intestinal contraction. They are given in post-operative paralytic alias. Then we have stool softener, then docusate and mineral oils. So this is the complete list of the drugs which are known as laxatives and purgatives. Okay. Now similarly, we have certain drugs which are given for the treatment of constipation, for the treatment of diarrhea. Now we have certain anti-motility drug like opioids, loperamide, which is a non-addictive opioid. Diphenoxylate, it's an addictive opioid which reduces motility. Hence, we combine atropine with diphenoxylate to reduce the motility. We have certain new drugs like fidotozine, alixadolone, and resicadrotel. We have 5-HT3 antagonist, elocitron, given in irritable bowel syndrome, mebivirine, which is a dopamine depleter, octreotide, given in secretory diarrheas, and clonidine, which is given in diabetic diarrheas and irritable bowel syndrome. Now, overall, for the treatment of diarrhea, remember anti-motility and anti-secretory drugs or adsorbent, they are very rarely used. The main treatment of diarrhea is fluid replacement. Okay, so we give fluid replacement. So we will be discussing various fluid analogs, like we give ORS, which is also known as oral rehydration salt, which is should be given in 1 liter of water. So what is the formula of ORS? There is an older ORS formula given by WHO, which was known as standard ORS. In that standard ORS, that's the composition of that ORS was based upon the diarrhea which was caused by cholera. But now we have new ORS formula which is based upon the diarrhea caused by ETEC diarrhea, enterotoxigenic E. coli diarrhea. So if you compare standard ORS with new ORS, standard ORS contained very high amount of sodium and high amount of glucose. This high amount of sodium leads to periorbital edema and fluid retention. So that was discouraged. Now we made new ORS formula. It contains relatively lesser amount of sodium. Earlier it was 90, now it is 75. Okay. The glucose content is also now less. It is 75. Okay. So earlier the osmolarity of that ORS was 311 milliosmol per liter. Now it is 245 milliosmol per liter. So the content is also given in grams of new ORS formula. Now what is the rationale? The rationale is we give electrolyte sodium potassium chloride to replenish their loss. We give trisodium citrate in new ORS formula to correct acidosis and to increase the absorption of sodium citrate. The main success of ORS is due to addition of glucose. This glucose does not provide energy. It is not for energy production provide. Remember, it is given to absorb the increase the absorption of sodium from intestine with the help of sodium glucose cotransporter. Okay. Earlier, instead of trisodium citrate, we were using sodium bicarbonate, but it was having a very short shelf life and it was turning the color of that solution brown. Okay. Nowadays, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, they also recommend to add zinc also, zinc supplementation also. So zinc is given in this dose 20 milligram above 6 months and 10 milligram in below 6 months of age. And zinc has been shown that it reduces the frequency of diarrhea and it reduces the recurrence of diarrhea. Why? It protects mucus and causes mucosal growth so that the better absorption of nutrients should occur. And it reduces, increases immunity, and it also reduces the fluid because it decreases cyclic MP level inside the cell. So this is the normal things about diarrhea and constipation that you must remember. Let's talk about the drugs. Now, which of the following drug increases intestinal motility? The answer out here is neostigmine. Okay. Neostigmine is given in post-operative paralytic ileus. Okay. It is a cholinergic drug, which we have already discussed. Okay, cholinergic drugs. Now what about glycopyrrolate? Remember, glycopyrrolate causes constipation, atropine causes constipation, fentanyl causes constipation. They all reduce intestinal motility. Which of the following purgative or laxative increases fecal bulk? So they are talking about bulk laxative due to water adsorbing and retaining capacity. So you have to find a bulk laxative. The answer for this question is methyl cellulose. Okay, so I have shown you the list. The answer is methyl cellulose. Lactulose, so it's a bulk laxative. Lactulose, remember, is an osmotic diuretic. Paraffin is also. Sodium dioctyl sodium sulfosuccinate, which is also known as DOS or docusate. It is a stool softener. Okay. Which laxative acts by opening of chloride channel? We have already discussed. It was lubiprostone and linaclotide. Okay. A prokinetic drug which lacks D2 receptor antagonist activity. I think we have already discussed this question. So the answer is sizapride. Sizapride has only 5-HT4 agonist property. Rest all other drugs, they have D2 blocking property as well. All of the following statement about treatment of diarrhea are correct except. Okay. So opioids, they delay the passage of gut content by reducing peristalsis. Yes, opioids, remember, they reduce intestinal motility. It's absolutely true. Loperamide is an opioid with anti-motility action. It's absolutely true. And it has no addictive potential as well. Anti-motility drugs are the best drug for infective diarrhea. Remember, false. They should not be given for infective diarrhea. Okay, unless that diarrhea is life-threatening. Diphenoxylate is an opioid. It can cause respiratory depression. Yes, opioids can cause respiratory depression. Hence, we add atropin with diphenoxylate to prevent its abuse. So the answer is anti-motility drugs are not a mainstay of treatment. Remember, it is fluid replacement which is the mainstay of treatment of anti-infective diarrhea with antimicrobials. So I'll just show you in which diarrhea you should give antimicrobial, in which diarrhea there is no role of antimicrobials. So in some diarrhea only we give antimicrobial, in some small amount of diarrhea. So there is no value of antimicrobial in diarrheas which are due to celiac disease, irritable bowel syndrome, tropical sprue, pancreatic deficiency and thyrotoxicosis. There is no role of antimicrobial, it should not be given. Second is antimicrobial only should be given in severe cases of certain infective diarrhea, like traveler's diarrhea, which is non-invasive, hepatic encephalopathy, enteropathogenic, Shigella dysentery, Yersinia enterocolitica, Shigella enteroiditis, and non-salmonella. Only in severe cases we must give. And in certain diarrheas, it is mandatory to give antimicrobial. These are cholera. We give azithromycin, now is considered drug of choice. But doxycycline is also used. Campylobacter, we give norfloxacin. Clostridium difficile, overall the drug of choice is oral vancomycin. Protozoans like amoebiasis, etc., we give metronidazole. So this is the summary of antimicrobials in the diarrhea. Okay. Now, which of the following drug is used in the treatment of constipation predominant IBS? So I'll just show you the treatment of irritable bowel syndrome. Irritable bowel syndrome is a very long-term disease in which the patient has repetitive episodes of diarrhea and repetitive episodes of constipation. And sometimes patient complains of abdominal pain due to spasm, abdominal spasm. So if the patient of diarrhea predominant IBS comes to you, we start with bulk laxatives. Not controlled, we give opioid loperamide. Not controlled, we give allocetron. Allocetron is mainly effective in females, not in males. Still not controlled, we can give clonidine. While in constipation predominant, we can again give bulk laxative. Remember, bulk laxatives are given in both. Not responsive, we give laxative like polyethylene glycol. Not responsive, we give chloride secretors like lubiprostone, linaclotide and plicanatide. For abdominal pain, we must give antispasmodic drugs. They are anti-muscarinic drugs like hyoscine, atropine and tricyclic antidepressants because they have anti-muscarinic action. So this is the treatment of irritable bowel syndrome. Keeping this thing in mind, let's see. Which of the following drug is used for the treatment of constipation predominant? The answer is lubiprostone. It's a chloride secretor. Okay. So answer is lubiprostone. Which of the following agents are used in medical treatment of variceal bleeding? Remember, for the treatment of variceal bleeding, the drug of choice is octreotide. It is a somatostatin hormone. It can suppress or constrict the dilated esophageal varices. You can also use terlipressin. They both are vasoconstrictor. So the answer out here is octreotide. Stimulant purgatives are contraindicated in the following conditions. Remember, stimulant purgatives, they cause intestinal contraction. They directly cause intestinal muscle contraction. Okay, because of this reason, they are absolutely contraindicated in spastic colon, and they are absolutely contraindicated in intestinal obstruction. So if there is already an obstruction, don't contract the intestine. So the answer for this question is subacute intestinal obstruction. But remember, they are given in bedridden, they are given before abdominal radiography to evacuate the bowel. So this is the contraindication of this drug. The drug used in irritable bowel syndrome with constipation. The answer for this question we have already discussed is lubiprostone. It's a chloride secretor. it is given. But remember, what about loperamide, clonidine and elocetron? Remember, they are given for diarrhea predominant IBS. They are given for diarrhea predominant IBS. The reason is they reduce the motility of intestine. Now, which of the following laxative lowers blood ammonia level in hepatic encephalopathy? The answer is lactulose. Okay. Remember, lactulose converts ammonia in the intestine into ammonium. Remember, this ammonium is water soluble. This ammonium cannot be absorbed into the blood. Okay, it cannot be absorbed into the blood because lactulose converts ammonia into ammonium. So if there is liver failure, normally ammonia can be converted into urea, but in liver failure, this ammonia will not be converted into urea, which can lead to encephalopathy. A small amount of atropine is added to diphenoxylate to prevent its abuse. So the answer is discourage overuse and abuse of diphenoxylate. An Aryan, a 14-year-old boy, presented with chronic diarrhea, weight loss. History reveals repeated attacks of respiratory tract infection with severe respiratory infection at the age of 7. That means from birth, that child is having continuous attacks of very low respiratory tract. And the child is having chronic diarrhea. That means chronic diarrhea means there will be malabsorption. Now remember, malabsorption with recurrent respiratory tract infection. Think about a disease known as cystic fibrosis. Because in cystic fibrosis, the ducts of pancreas, they get blocked, which can lead to malabsorption. There is chronic pancreatitis or chronic pancreas enzyme deficiency. And in cystic fibrosis, the mucus in the lungs becomes very hard. This mucus cannot move upwards and the infection may go inside the lung. It may cause mucus impaction, hard mucus, which may lead to respiratory infection. And due to chronic enzyme deficiency, there is chronic diarrhea due to chronic malabsorption. Okay. So can you tell me which drug would you like to give in this patient? Which drug? Remember, the answer is pancreatic lipase. Because as there is enzyme deficiency, hence we give pancreatic lipase enzyme from outside. Now what is bisacodyl? Remember, we have already discussed that bisacodyl is a stimulant laxative. Okay, it's a stimulant laxative. Best treatment of irritable bowel syndrome with spastic colon. Remember, in spastic colon, stimulant laxatives are absolutely contraindicated. And in spastic colon, the drug of choice is bulk laxatives. Because bulk laxatives, they stretch intestine, they can open the intestine by increasing the bulk. So remember, A, C and D are the example of stimulant laxative. The answer is dietary fibers, which is the example of bulk laxatives. Drug used in hepatic encephalopathy. Wherever the word hepatic encephalopathy comes, marked lactulose. It converts ammonia into ammonium. Diarrhea which responds to antibiotic therapy is tropical sprue. We have discussed, no, we should not give antimicrobial and tropical sprue. We should not give in irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, we should not give in. Okay, we should not give. But in severe cases of travelers diarrhea and salmonella, we give antimicrobials. Okay. Which drug causes melanosis coli or black discoloration of intestine? The answer is Senna. That is why it becomes very difficult to sometimes do colonoscopy in the presence of Senna. Now, anthrol, we have discussed, there were two anthrol, that was Senna and Cascara, and they were stimulant laxatives or irritant laxative. The answer is irritant laxatives. Constipation is caused by all of the following except, remember, opioid, yes, they cause constipation, true, hence they are given in the treatment of diarrhea. Codeine is also an opioid. Verapamil, a calcium channel blocker, again an opioid. The answer is magnesium. We have discussed magnesium causes, is a laxative, it causes diarrhea. Okay. Choose the correct statement about the use of opioid anti-motility drugs in the management of diarrhea. Okay. They are used to control diarrhea irrespective of etiology. False. Remember, they should not be given in infective diarrhea. They should only be given in non-infective secretory diarrhea. We don't suppress motility of intestine during infection because during diarrhea, the infection can move out of the intestine due to increased motility. They should be given as a short-term measure after ensuring non-invasive, enteroinvasive organisms are not involved. This is the main rationale of giving antimicrobial agent. So that if there is an infection, that infection should not be an invasive and they should be given for a short-term measure. Okay, so this is the main answer. Now, they are used for the irritable bowel syndrome. Yes, they can be given for the treatment of irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, but are the drug of choice? No, we start with bulk laxative. They are used in irritable bowel syndrome, but they are not the drug of choice. They are used as an adjuvant for antimicrobial therapy. Yes, but not in all antimicrobial therapy. So these statements are partially correct, partially incorrect. A 46-year-old male present to OPD with diarrhea and pain. On investigation, he was found to be a non-infective and you proceed with diphenoxylate therapy. Which of the following is the primary target of this drug you prescribe? Remember, diphenoxylate is an opioid. And opioids, they are anti-motility drugs. They reduce the motility of intestine. And the answer for this question is motility. Okay. Diarrhea and loose stools are the side effects of misoprostol. Okay. Misoprostol is a prostaglandin E1 analog. Okay. It causes increase in chloride secretion and it increases intestinal contraction. Okay, hence it may produce diarrhea and loose stools. And diarrhea is the most common side effect of misoprostol. What is methyl polysiloxane? It's a defoaming agent. Okay, it bursts bubbles. So now let's come to the treatment of inflammatory bowel disease. Remember, there are two varieties of inflammatory bowel disease. One is Crohn's disease and second is ulcerative colitis. Okay, so let's see the treatment of Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. So if you talk about the treatment of first Crohn's disease, it starts from ileocecal junction, the most common area, and it also shows skip lesions. It may ascend upwards towards the stomach or it may descend towards the rectum. So for the acute treatment of Crohn's disease, remember the drug of choice for induction or for the acute attack is corticosteroids. For mild cases or the overall corticosteroid we use is oral budesonide, which is the most preferred corticosteroid in Crohn's disease. While in severe condition, you can start with prednisolone and sometime intravenous drug like methylprednisolone and hydrocortisone, which are generally all are corticosteroid. Now, if there is no response to corticosteroid, this is known as corticosteroid resistant cases. And we maintain corticosteroid for 1 and 2 months and we gradually taper off the dose. And when there is tapering of dose, again, there is recurrence of Crohn's disease. It is known as steroid-dependent Crohn's disease. In steroid-dependent cases, remember the drug of choice is azathioprine. But you can also use 6-mercaptopurine and methotrexate. In steroid-resistant cases, the drug of choice is cyclosporine. And in cyclosporine-resistant case, we give tacrolimus. And if it is still not responsive, we give anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibody. Like infliximab, sertolizumab, adalimumab. Ustekinumab and tocilizumab are the other two new drugs which are approved for Crohn's disease. Now for the maintenance, remember we don't give corticosteroid for long term because they can cause Cushing syndrome. Hence we maintain with azathioprine. Azathioprine is the drug of choice for maintenance to prevent again recurrent attack or relapse. Still not controlled, we give same anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibodies. If it is still not controlled, we can give anti-integrin monoclonal antibody like vedolizumab and earlier we were using natalizumab. Okay. So this is the treatment of Crohn's disease, and a very similar treatment to is of ulcerative colitis only. But before corticosteroid, just add one drug, 5-ASA compound. The treatment is absolutely same. So for induction, we give 5-ASA compound, known as 5-aminosalicylic acid compound, mesalamine, best drug, sulfasalazine, olsalazine, and balsalazide. They are also given for maintenance, but they are only effective in mild cases. Hence, remember, the drug of choice for induction is not 5-ASA. They are the most commonly used drug. The drug of choice for acute attack of ulcerative colitis is always corticosteroids. Same way we will give, just like in Crohn's disease, steroid-dependent azathioprine, steroid-resistant cyclosporin, tacrolimus, anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibody. But here there is no role of methotrexate. Methotrexate is mainly given in Crohn's, not in ulcerative colitis. And same is the treatment of maintenance. Okay. Now there is a drug, tofacitinib, which have been approved for ulcerative colitis. It's an oral JAK kinase 1 and 3 inhibitor. It's an oral drug, tofacitinib. It is mainly given for maintenance therapy. It is an oral JAK inhibitor. So this is the treatment of ulcerative colitis. So keeping this thing in mind, let's solve the questions of inflammatory bowel disease. Which of the following is not given in Crohn's disease? So the drug which is not given in Crohn's disease is, the answer is infliximab. Yes, it has been approved. Ustekinumab, yes, recently it has been approved. Natalizumab, yes, it has been approved. But remember, now there is a point that adalimumab is the answer. But now adalimumab can be used as an off-label use. Off-label means it is not approved, but it is still given. But it is still can be given, because it is just like infliximab, anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibody. It is not approved, but it still can be given. Sulfasalazine is only given in ulcerative colitis, remember. It is 5-ASA compound. There is one more use of sulfasalazine. It is also given in rheumatoid arthritis. Why? It has two forms, two active drugs, that is 5-ASA and sulfapyridine. Sulfapyridine moiety is effective in rheumatoid arthritis. So for that complete details, please refer to the videos of rheumatoid arthritis. The therapeutic effect of sulfasalazine in ulcerative colitis is exerted by, it is due to the breakdown of colon by releasing 5-ASA, which suppress inflammation locally. 5-ASA, 5-aminosalicylic acid. The preferred drug for controlling acute attack. Remember, the drug of choice for acute attack is always and always corticosteroids. For either it is ulcerative colitis or it is Crohn's disease. So try to find a corticosteroid that is prednisolone. Sulfa drug used in inflammatory bowel disease was sulfasalazine. Which of the following is used in the treatment of Crohn's disease? The answer is all of the following. All. They all are used in the treatment of Crohn's disease. Okay. So let's talk about, we have already discussed about ORS. Let's talk about a few points about probiotics and the drugs for gallstones also. Okay. So if you talk about probiotics, gallstones. So these are the drugs we have for gallstones. Okay, so they help in dissolving the gallstones. So they are bile acids. Bile acids will remove the surface tension, and hence they will reduce the precipitation of gallstones. These are quinodeoxycholic acid, ursodeoxycholic acid, and abetocholic acid. Okay, then we have hypolipidemic agents which reduce the cholesterol content in the bile, like statins, ezetimibe, and fibrates. Okay, hypolipidemic agents. Then we have the drugs for short bowel syndrome. Short bowel syndrome means small absorption due to small intestine. So why there is small intestine? Either you have removed it surgically or congenitally, it is very small. The main treatment of short bowel syndrome is total parenteral nutrition. Okay, this is the mainstay. And then we will try to increase the growth of mucosa so that malabsorption should not occur. We give teduglutide. It is a recombinant GLP-2 analog. Glucagon-like peptide, okay, which increases insulin-like growth factor, which causes mucosal growth. You can also give recombinant growth hormone somatropin. Now, you have to reduce malabsorption by reducing HCL production by giving proton pump inhibitor and H2 blocker. You reduce diarrhea by giving opioids. Okay, You also reduce diarrhea by giving opioids. So this was the treatment of short bowel syndrome and gallstones. Okay. So let's talk about now the questions. Why glucose is added to ORS? The mainstay of adding glucose to the ORS is to increase the absorption of sodium. Okay. To increase the absorption of sodium by co-transportation. Okay. Now next question is asking, probiotics are used in. Now what are probiotics? Remember, probiotics are the group of drugs which are symbiotic bacteria and fungi. Okay, they are the group of symbiotic bacteria and fungi. So these bacteria could be various types like lactobacillus, bifidobacterium, fungi like streptomyces, yeast, etc. So why they are given? When, remember, these bacteria, they prevent the growth of intestinal cells, they maintain a healthy environment. So the point is, where they are given, remember, they are the mainstay of treatment for necrotizing enterocolitis. Okay. Necrotizing enterocolitis is seen in a newborn baby. Due to lack of this symbiotic bacteria, their intestine may get damaged easily. They are also given in antibiotic associated diarrhea, because antibiotics, they kill the symbiotic bacteria. They are also given in pseudomembranous colitis. Why? Because in pseudomembranous colitis, the harmful bacteria Clostridium difficile grows. Okay. Now the concentration of sodium ions in standard ORS formula. In standard ORS formula, it was 90. But in now new ORS formula, it is 75. Okay. So the standard answer will be 90. Which of the following statement about the new ORS formula is true? The sodium concentration is 75. It's absolutely true. The glucose concentration is equal to sodium. It's absolutely true. The total osmolarity is 245 milliosmol per liter. Again, true. The answer is all of the following. Which of the following oral rehydration salt solution concentration? The answer out here, I'll show you that list again. Just see that list of ORS composition. So this was the composition. On the right side, we have new ORS, sodium 75, potassium 20, chloride 65, citrate 10, and glucose 75. Total 245. Okay. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see the options. Sodium 70. No, sir, it's 75. Potassium 20. It's absolutely true. Okay. So the answer out here is B. Now the success of ORS in diarrhea depends upon which of the following process in intestinal mucosa? The main success of ORS is due to addition of glucose, because this glucose added helped in absorption of sodium. Okay, this is the success of ORS. Okay. The new ORS formula differed from older standard WHO formula is, it has lower sodium content. It's absolutely true. Earlier it was 90, now it is 75. It has higher potassium concentration. It has higher potassium concentration. The answer is false. No. It has no basic salt. False. It has trisodium citrate. So the answer out here is A. Apart from diarrhea, ORS can be given in. You'll write B and C. Apart from this, ORS can be given in burn cases. Yes, we give ORS because of fluid loss and heat stroke. These are the other uses of ORS apart from diarrhea. Okay. Not true about composition of standard ORS. Just see that the answer is bicarbonate. Okay. It is not true. Rest everything is false. Which of the following drug is useful in dissolving gallstones? The answer was quinodeoxycholic acid. Okay. So this was all about GIT. Thank you very much for listening. For the complete details, you can subscribe for the videos also. Okay. So thank you very much.